book of Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10, and we're going to read from verses 1 through 10. I'm going to talk to you tonight a little bit about the cross. I'm going to talk to you about the atonement. I'm going to talk to you about why Jesus died just a little bit, because there is no topic that is more important to us, and there is no subject that informs our view of God more than this whole subject of why did Jesus die, and who's the one who put him to death, and for what purpose was he put to death. Your understanding of those ideas will inform your view of God, and your view of God dictates how you live your life. So it's extremely important that we understand why the cross occurred and at whose hands Christ suffered. Okay, so let's go to Hebrews chapter 10, verses 1 through 10, and let me start off by telling you just a little story. So I grew up in northern Michigan, and part of my daily routine was wandering in the woods for about 4 to 5 hours a day, and I never got kidnapped or mauled by a bear. Isn't that amazing? And so that was just sort of life, and my friends and I would just get together, and we'd roam through the woods, and we would just carry big old knives with us and jump from trees and just act crazy and just do a bunch of stupid stuff that I hope my kids never do. And so anyways, one of our favorite things to do was find dead trees and kick them over, because it made us feel so powerful. And here we are, these 7-8-year-old kids, but when we go up to these dead rotted trees, we kick them down and we just feel so awesome about ourselves. And so we were out in the woods one day and we saw this big, huge dead tree, and I wanted a piece of that thing so bad because it was so big and so monstrous, and I knew kicking that thing down would make me feel like the Incredible Hulk. But my friend got to it first, and he charged it and he fell it with a mighty ninja kick. But as it fell, all of a sudden it was like a cloud exploded when it fell, and the cloud I came to know were yellow jackets. And my friend got absolutely covered in these things. And at first we didn't know what they were. He just started screaming and swatting and going crazy. I'm like, what the heck is he doing? He's lost his mind. He's gone mad. And he was just freaking out, slapping himself and running around. And then we realized what happened. And so he just darted past us as fast as he could, screaming like a little girl, running towards home. And we just followed behind him screaming because we didn't know what else to do. And so he gets home and he runs through his front door, and the screen door slams, and my other friend and I, we're just waiting outside like, what the heck is going on? We don't even know what to do. And all of a sudden, I just hear his dad screaming, just like, what's going on? Just this huge, deep, booming voice, just, and we're terrified. Here we are, 7-8-year-old kids. I think that's about what age we were, and we just, what the heck is going on? My friend's screaming. He's getting attacked by bees. His dad's screaming, just, wow, what's going on? And then all of a sudden, we just start here, smack, 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 boom, 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 and my friend is, he's screaming, and his dad is just, and in my childish mind, I was not putting two and two together. I wasn't realizing that the father was rescuing the son from the bees that were trying to attack him. I didn't realize that was what was happening. My childish mind interpreted the event way differently. I thought that for some reason his dad was mad at him for, I don't know, coming in the house with bees all over him. I don't know what the reason I thought he was mad at him was, but that's how my childish mind interpreted the event. I thought that his dad was mad at him for something and was beating the crap out of him. That was how I interpreted what was going on. I was just like, what is he doing? Why is he killing our friend? I mean, that was how my mind interpreted it. I couldn't get it any other way. And all of a sudden, after a few minutes of just pure trauma of my friend and I just sitting there thinking our friend was getting killed by his father, his mom opens the door and is like, you guys just should probably go home. Yeah, you know, maybe you can play tomorrow. Like, okay, obviously what was happening was his father was saving him. Obviously what was happening was that the father's love rose up and protected his son and did so fiercely, but our childish minds misinterpreted what was happening, and we saw it as abuse when it was actually rescue. Now, unfortunately, we have interpreted the cross through a very similar lens. We look at the cross of Jesus Christ, and instead of seeing God rescuing us from the power of sin and from the power of death, we have seen an abusive father who cannot forgive without shedding blood. And God forbid that God would simply just forgive. He had to have a sacrificial victim in order to be able to say, you're off the hook and you're forgiven. God couldn't just say, okay, it's over, it's good, I forgive you. He couldn't do that. He is so obsessed with justice, and he is so obsessed with having his own judicial itches scratched that he himself had to become a human being so he could beat the snot out of himself so that he could let us off the hook. And you try to wrap your mind around that, and you realize how absolutely absurd of a doctrine that is. But that is what often gets passed off as the gospel, that God is universally angry at all men, and he is bound by justice to judge them. But somehow, and for some reason, he doesn't want to, even though he does want to. So the only solution is for him to become a human being and pour out his own wrath on himself to appease himself. It's like, God, I think you could have done this a whole lot. I think you could have done this a better way, like maybe just forgiving us. I mean, instead of having to torture and murder yourself. But the truth is, that's not what happened, and the Bible does not teach that. But our childish minds interpret this event the same way that my childish mind interpreted my friend's father saving him from a swarm of yellow jackets. I thought it was abuse. I thought that it spoke to this father's deviousness. I thought it spoke to something wicked and twisted in his father. But the fact of the matter was, I was witnessing an act of heroism and love, but my mind interpreted it incorrectly. And we've done the same thing with the cross for years, and no wonder nobody wants the gospel we're peddling, because our God is a moral monster. George MacDonald said, hey, look, if you want to worship Molech, worship Molech. Just don't call him Yahweh. Okay, so let's go to the scriptures here for a minute, if I haven't already lost you. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 10, verses 1 through 10. The writer says, the law is only a shadow of the good things that are coming, not the realities themselves. And in context, the law that's being discussed here is not necessarily laws 1 through 10 or laws 1 through 613. What's being discussed is the sacrificial system of the Old Testament. And we're told that the law, with its sacrifices, was only a shadow of the good things that were coming, not the realities themselves. Now, let me ask you something. Can something have a shadow if it is not already in existence? The answer is no. Something cannot have a shadow unless it already exists. And the Bible says that the law was only the shadow of the good things that were coming, not the realities themselves. That means that if the sacrificial system was just a shadow of the finished work of Christ, that the finished work of Christ precedes the sacrificial system since it had a shadow. Because the Bible says in Revelation 13:8, the Lamb was slain before creation. The Bible says that we were saved in Christ and that we were chosen in him before creation. Before there was ever a problem, there was already a remedy. Before there was ever a test, the answers were already given. Do you get that? The law is the shadow of what Christ accomplished, because he accomplished it in eternity. And the law was simply the reverse two-dimensional projection of what God had accomplished in eternity. And for years, we've looked at the two-dimensional reverse projection of the animal sacrificial system, and we've tried to figure out the work of Christ by studying the shadow. But the truth is, we don't get our definition of what the cross was about by studying the shadow. We start with the substance, and we interpret the shadow in light of the substance, not vice versa. Amen. But for years, I've heard sermons preached, even by well-meaning grace guys, and they try to talk about the work of Christ, but they start with Moses, and they start with the sacrificial system, and they try to explain Christ's work by taking us through Moses. No, that's not the way it works. What Moses had was a two-dimensional reverse projection, just a shadow. That's all it was. I can look at your shadow, and I can't tell what gender you are. I can't tell what color your hair is or what color your eyes are. I can't tell much about you by looking at your shadow, but if I look at you, and I get a good idea of what you look like, then I can look at your shadow and I can make sense of it, because I've seen the substance. But for years, we've tried to take the substance and take the shadow and interpret the substance in light of the shadow. But you got to start with the substance, and then the shadow makes sense. You don't start with Adam, Moses, and then work your way to Jesus. You start with Jesus, and then you work your way to Adam and Moses. The law was only a shadow of the good things that are coming, not the realities themselves. And for this reason, it can never, by the same sacrifices repeated endlessly year after year, make perfect those who draw near to worship. Otherwise, they would have stopped being offered. For the worshipers would have been cleansed once for all and would no longer have felt guilty for their sins. But these sacrifices are simply annual reminders of sins. For it is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Therefore, when Christ came into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering you did not desire. Did you hear that? When Christ came into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me. With burnt offerings and sin offerings, you were not pleased. Then I said, here am I, Jesus says. It is written about me in the scroll. I have come to do your will, my God. First, he said, sacrifices and offerings, burnt offerings and sin offerings you did not desire, nor were you pleased with them, though they were offered in accordance with the law. Though they were offered in accordance with the law, Jesus said God did not desire them, nor was he pleased with them. Then he said, here I am, I have come to do your will. And he sets aside the first to establish the second. In other words, he sets aside the sacrificial system to establish the second, which was the will of God, which he came to accomplish in the body that God prepared for him. And by that will, which was accomplished through the body God prepared for Jesus, we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. This little beautiful passage of scripture right here smashes a whole lot of bad theology and a whole lot of old paradigms to powder. Because what we have here is we have Jesus telling us that the God whom we worship is not the sacrifice-demanding pagan deity that we thought he was. Because we've thought... I'm getting excited about this. We have thought that our God was just like the gods of the Canaanites and just like the gods of the Babylonians and just like the gods of the Persians who demanded sacrifices. He needed to be appeased by blood. And so we set up a system in which we bring him bulls and goats or turtle doves or whatever it was that particular day of the week. And you offer this animal's blood and you appease God and you earn his favor and you turn aside his wrath temporarily. And we've seen these animal sacrifices as being something like the hors d'oeuvres that come before the main course, but eventually God was no longer satisfied with the hors d'oeuvres, and he was like, bring out the main course. And Jesus burst through the kitchen doors at the last moment, and he presents God with the sacrifice of his own body. And finally God consumes the sacrifice of his son, burps, wipes his mouth, and says, I'm satisfied. I no longer require sacrifice. I no longer require animal sacrifices because I'm satisfied with the perfect work of my son. But what Jesus reveals to us in this passage of scripture is that God never desired sacrifice. He never desired animal blood. God did not get off on watching animals have their throats slit. That was never who God was. That was the gods of the nations, but that was never our God. Jesus says, sacrifices and offerings you didn't desire. You are not into the smoke of burnt offerings or the blood of sacrifices. That's not who you are. Sacrifice and offering you didn't desire. Burnt offerings and sin offerings you weren't pleased, but a body you prepared for me, and I've come to do your will. And the Bible says he sets aside the first, the sacrificial system, in order to establish the second being the will of God that Jesus came to accomplish in a body. And we'll get back to all of this in just a few minutes, but let's stop for a minute and let's talk about this whole thing of sacrifice as it pertains to the work of Jesus. Because you know something? This is a really hard thing to get people to understand, because we see the sacrifice of Jesus as being the ultimate sacrifice. Jesus was just like a bull or a goat sacrifice on steroids. I mean, he was like Passover on steroids. It was just like the perfect sacrifice. What those sacrifices could never do, Jesus did, because he was perfect and he was blameless. But then what we would have to believe about God is that not only is our God into animal sacrifices, but he's also into human sacrifices, because that's what Jesus was. He was a human being. And are you prepared to say that our God is into human sacrifices? But that's what we have to say if we say that Jesus was a sacrifice in that sense of a sacrifice. What I want to show you for just a few minutes here is that God was never into sacrifice in that sense of the word. Why are there sacrifices in the Bible then? Well, why I believe there are sacrifices in the Bible is because, as the Bible tells us, these things were just a shadow of the good things that were coming, not the realities themselves. In eternity, God already planned to save us from our sins through the death of his son, because his son takes our iniquities and sins upon himself, and then he destroys them through death. Now, that substance had a shadow that looked like animal sacrifices, but animal sacrifices were not the substance. They were just an obscure shadow. The substance was the death of Christ, which took place in eternity, in which we were saved from sins. But that substantial work had a shadow that projected outwards and looked like animal sacrifices, and human beings over time adapted this practice, and the rest is history. But let's talk about sacrifice from the Old Testament just for a few minutes to lay some groundwork. Deuteronomy 32, 37 through 38, we have God here drawing a line of distinction between himself and the pagan gods with whom the Israelites were familiar. And he says, he will say, now where are their gods, little g, the rock they took refuge in, the gods who ate the fat of their sacrifices and drank the wine of their drink offerings? Let them rise up to help you, and let them give you shelter. And what God is doing here is he's drawing a line of distinction between himself and the false gods of the nations, because the false gods of the nations are those who eat the meat of sacrifices and they drink the blood of sacrifices. They are gods who are pleased and appeased by sacrificial blood. They're gods that you have to earn their favor by presenting them with blood. You have to secure their blessing by presenting them with a sacrifice. And God says, look, I am not a God who eats the meat of the sacrifices you offer, nor do I drink the blood of the sacrifices you offer. That just is not who I am. Psalms 57 through 16, listen to this. God says, listen, my people, and I will speak, and I will testify against you, Israel. I am God, your God, and I bring no charges against you concerning your sacrifices or concerning your burnt offerings, which are ever before me. So right here we have God saying, look, I've allowed you to offer sacrifices to me, and I accept them as a form of worship because it's the only way you know how to worship me. Now, Maimonides, a 15th century rabbi, 14th century rabbi, medieval rabbi, taught that sacrifices were just throwbacks to paganism. And since the world was so filled with pagan ritual and sacrifice, that God said to the human race, I'll let you speak to me in the language you understand because I get that you don't know how else to do this. And so I know you don't really have a clear revelation of me, so I'll let you bring me sacrifices if that satisfies something in you for a certain time. But there will come a time where I'm going to shut this whole system down. And I'm going to show you that that's not who I am, and that's not how I operate. If you go all the way back to the first sacrifice ever offered in linear time, it happens just after the fall when God slays an animal in order to clothe Adam and Eve with its skins. Now, if you go back to that sacrifice, for whose benefit was the sacrifice? Was it for God's benefit? No, because God was not offended by Adam and Eve's nakedness. It was for Adam and Eve's benefit. And I think there we have a picture of why sacrifice operated in the first place, because it gave us something of a little bit of confidence to come before God, because we felt naked and we felt like we needed something to cover us. And sacrifice was kind of a way that we felt like we could approach God. Why it took place that way, I don't know, but I do know it was not part of the original design of creation. It's a result of the fall, and it isn't something that God ever desired or took pleasure in. It was a way that he allowed us to approach him because it made sense to us, but it was not a part of his original design. So God says to Israel, look, I bring no charges against you concerning your sacrifices or concerning your burnt offerings, which are ever before me, but I have no need of a bull from your stall or of a goat from your pens. Did you hear that? God says, look, I don't bring any charges against you for what you do. I receive it and I know your heart's in it, but let me tell you something about who I am. I don't require this and I don't need it. I have no need of a bull from your stall or of a goat from your pens, for every animal of the forest is mine and the cattle on 1,000 hills. What God is saying is, look, if I was interested in drinking the blood of bulls and goats, I'd be popping straws and cows like juice boxes and sucking them dry every other day of the week, but I'm not into that stuff. I have no need of a bull from your stalls. The cattle on 1,000 hills are mine. If I wanted to eat sacrificial meat and blood, I'd be doing it right now. Don't think you're doing me a favor by bringing me a dead animal. I mean, my cat brings me dead animals, and I'm not too impressed, right? God's like, look, I understand. But at the same time, I'm like, you know, thank you to the cat. I know he thinks he's doing good. He's bringing me a dead mouse, and I don't know what he thinks I do with it, but he's all impressed. You know what I'm saying? He brings the dead mouse, and he's like, he's all proud. And I'm like, yeah, you did good, but that thing's disgusting. Get it out of the house. I'm not really into that. I think that's sort of how sacrifices worked. It was what we thought God wanted. It was the way we thought it worked because we developed this violent mindset in the aftermath of the fall. And so we bring God sacrifices and we're like, did I do good? Did I do good? And God's like, yeah, you did good. But look, I'm not into this. I have no need of a bull from your stall or of a goat from your pens, for every animal of the forest is mine and the cattle on 1,000 hills. I know every bird in the mountains and the insects of the fields are mine. If I were hungry, I wouldn't tell you. If I were hungry, I wouldn't tell you, for the world is mine and all that is in it. Do I eat the flesh of bulls or drink the blood of goats? And the obvious answer is no. Sacrifice thank offerings to God, fulfill your vows to the Most High, and call on me in the day of trouble, and I'll deliver you, and you will honor me. So still he says, look, I understand this is the way you do it, so go ahead and do it. But just know, I'm not some pagan deity who's drinking the blood of bulls and goats and eating the meat of sacrifices. That's not really who I am. I'm not some violent God who requires bloodshed. And then it goes on to say something really interesting in verse 16. It says, but to the wicked person, God says, what right have you to recite my laws or take my covenant on your lips? You hate my instruction and you cast my words behind you. When you see a thief, you join with him. You throw in your lot with adulterers. You use your mouth for evil and harness your tongue to deceit. You sit and testify against your brother and slander your own mother's son. When you did these things and I kept silent, you thought I was exactly like you. But now I arraign you and set my accusations before you. I want you to see what God's saying here. God is saying to Israel, look, you think that you can just go on treating people like garbage. You think you can just go treating people unjustly and defrauding people and just being mean. You think you can do that. But so long as there's a little bit of animal blood on the altar, all is well. And what God is saying is, look, that is not who I am. Look, that might go over with Molech. That might go over with Baal or Asherah. But that's not who I am. I'm a relational God, and I would much rather you treated each other correctly than I would you spilling animal blood all over the place. God's revealing something about his character and nature here. He's revealing something about what justice really looks like. Because justice to God is not a sacrificial victim getting what I deserve. Justice is wrong things being made right and you being good to people. And you doing justice in the sense of helping other people and treating other people correctly. God says, I'm much more into that than I am in you bringing me animal blood. This is important. Isaiah chapter 1 verse 11. Are you guys with me still? Okay, Isaiah 1:11, God says, the multitude of your sacrifices, what are they to me, says the Lord? I have more than enough of burnt offerings, of rams and the fat of fattened animals. I have no pleasure in the blood of bulls and lambs and goats. Did you hear that? God says he has no pleasure in the blood of bulls or lambs and goats. And again, you've got to pause and wonder, God, why do you talk like this when you're the very one who orders the sacrifices? Why do you order the sacrifices and then talk this way? But if we read on, if we read the surrounding context of this declaration by God, something begins to come into view. And in verses 16 and 17, God says to Israel, the same Israel he just said, I'm not into your sacrifices. He says, wash and make yourselves clean. Take your evil deed out of my sight. Stop doing wrong. Learn to do right. Seek justice. Defend the oppressed. And what does justice look like? In our 21st century Western mindset, justice is retributive. It's you've done something wrong, you're going to pay for it. And we insert that into our gospel message and we said we've all done wrong and we all deserve to get some justice. But God gave, you know, he still satisfied his just demands by pouring out his wrath on his son. And so he still got justice. We just didn't get what we deserved or what we had coming. But look here, it says, learn to do right and seek justice. What does justice look like? Defend the oppressed. Take up the cause of the fatherless. Plead the case of the widow. Justice in a biblical sense is doing justly towards one another. Treating each other correctly, coming to the aid of the poor and the widow and the abandoned, and that's justice. Why does God say to Israel, I'm not into your sacrifices? Because once more, they were acting in a way that was out of harmony with God's sense of justice. And he says, look, I don't care that there's a little blood sprinkled on the altar. I would much rather you just treated each other correctly. And in verse 10, right before God says, I'm not into your sacrifices, he says, hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom, listen to the instruction of our God, you people of Gomorrah. And then he goes on to address Israel, but before he addresses them, he calls them Sodom and Gomorrah. See, I'm telling you, God was not looking at these people who were sincerely offering him sacrifice and say, just knock it off, you people are dumb. No, he was like, these were people who were jacked up, who were hurting other people, who were defrauding people. And God was like, you think all is well because you bring me a sacrifice? This is not justice. This is justice. Help each other. Feed the poor. Clothe the naked. That's justice. This is pagan. And he calls them Sodomites. Now, again, in our 21st century Western Christian mindset, we think that that means homosexuality. That's what Sodom and Gomorrah means to us. Sodom and Gomorrah, their main sin was the sin of homosexuality in our minds. But that's not the main sin of Sodom and Gomorrah. Okay, check this out. Ezekiel 16, 49 through 50 says, now this was the sin of your sister Sodom. You want to know what Sodom's sin was? Here it comes. Now this was the sin of your sister Sodom. She and her daughters were arrogant, overfed, and unconcerned. They did not help the poor and needy. They were haughty and did detestable things before me. Therefore, I did away with them as you have seen. God says Sodom's sin. They were haughty. They did detestable things. They were unmoved by the plight of the poor. They didn't help people. They were overfed and unconcerned. Why do you think God in Isaiah chapter 1 calls Israel Sodom? Because they were doing the very things. They weren't doing real justice. But they were shedding animal blood and thinking that all was well. And God's like, you've got this thing wrong. That's not justice. Helping people is justice. Okay, this is going to get more and more important as we move along here. So Amos chapter 5, 21 and 24, God says, I despise your religious festivals. Your assemblies are a stench to me. God, why you got to be so mean? 22, even though you bring me burnt offerings and grain offerings, I'm not going to accept them. Though you bring me choice fellowship offerings, I have no regard for them. Are you starting to get the picture that God's not into sacrifice yet? Away with the noise of your songs. I'm not listening to the music of your harps. Why, God? Verse 24. But let justice roll on like a river, righteousness like a never-failing stream. Again, what is righteousness and justice to God? It's doing right to people. It's doing justly. It's helping the poor. It's caring for the widow. It's caring for the orphans. That is justice in God's sight. Again, God's saying, I'm not interested in rivers of animal blood. I'm interested in justice rolling on like a river. That's what I'm into, but you've got it wrong. You think I'm some pagan God. Shed a little blood, do what you want, and I'm okay. No, no, no. I'm a relational God. You treat each other correctly. You live right and you treat people right. You help the poor. That's justice to me. This is pagan and I'm not into it. Okay. In Mark 12, 28 through 34, Jesus is speaking to a very learned teacher of the law, and I won't read the whole passage of scripture to you, but Jesus is asked, you know, what is the most important of the commandments? And he says it's to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. Right? And in verse 33, let me just read it. Verse 33, it says, to love God with all your heart, with all your understanding, with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. So we see once more, the heart of God is not sacrifice. It's not bloody appeasement. It's do justice to one another. That is justice in God's sight. Animals being slain is not justice. That's pagan. Jeremiah 7, 21 through 24. This is a little bit more of a zinger, but listen to this. Jeremiah 7, 21 through 24. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, add your burnt offerings to your sacrifices and eat meat. Now, what does that mean? Well, the burnt offerings, they were not allowed to eat. And God says, you may as well just take your burnt offerings, which you're forbidden from eating, and add them together with your sacrifices and eat them both, because both are forbidden and I don't care. Okay? Verse 22, for I did not speak to your forefathers or command them in the day that I brought them out of the land of Egypt concerning burnt offerings or sacrifices. Did you hear that? God says, I did not command them regarding burnt offerings or sacrifices. But this is what I commanded them, saying, obey my voice, and I'll be your God, and you'll be my people. Walk in all my ways. I've commanded you that it may be well with you. In other words, God says, look, my main concern was not teaching you how to chop up a goat right and burn its body. That's not what I instructed your forefathers about. I told them, listen to me, live in harmony with one another. That's what I instructed them to do. That's all I've ever really wanted. You're bringing me rivers of animal blood, and you think I'm appeased by this. I'm not into that. Just treat each other right. Because justice to God looks like justice. It looks like me going to someone who's hurting and lifting them up out of the depths. It looks like me going to someone who's been abandoned and giving them shelter and giving them a home. That's justice to God. But to us, justice looks like you broke the rules and you're going to pay for it. That's what justice looks like to us. It looks like somebody's got to shed their blood. Somebody's got to pay for this crime. But to God, justice is no, 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 no. Let's go to the hurting and to the broken and exalt them and lift them up. And Israel had this warped sense of justice as well, and they think justice is being served when they sacrifice animals, but God is continually reminding them, that's not what justice looks like to me. Don't bring me blood and think all is well, because that's not what I'm into. Now, this is important. Isaiah 42, 3 through 4. We see again and again, every time God seems to express his disdain for animal sacrifices, he also includes a little bit of a message on what justice really is. And he reminds them that justice and sacrifice, real sacrifice to God, looks like real justice being done, which real sacrifice then means laying down your life for someone else. That's what real sacrifice is. Animal sacrifice is something we confuse for the real thing, but real sacrifice looks like laying your life down for someone to do justice for, to bring justice to their life. That's what real sacrifice is, but Israel thought it was just about blood. That was where the confusion came in. Now, in Isaiah 42 verses 3 through 4, we have a prophecy here about what Jesus Christ will accomplish when he comes. And it says, a bruised reed he will not break. In other words, he's going to treat the weak carefully. He's not going to break a bruised reed. And a dimly burning wick he will not extinguish. He doesn't come along to those who are dimly burning and not as passionate as we think they should be and snuff them out and say, that's not good enough for me. That's not the way he works. A bruised reed he will not break, and a dimly burning wick he will not extinguish. He will faithfully bring forth justice. Jesus comes to bring forth justice. And what does it look like? It looks like him coming alongside the dimly burning wick and the bruised reed and caring for them. That's justice. He will not be disheartened or crushed until he has established justice in the earth, and the coastlands will wait expectantly for his law. And what that literally means is the Gentiles will wait for his word. And what justice looks like here is justice looks like the fact that the Gentiles had been excluded for millennia because they didn't have the law, and they were on the other side of the law, and Israel's in there having their little God party saying that the Gentiles are excluded and not part of the covenant. And God says, I'm going to establish real justice by tearing down the law that's become a dividing wall of hostility, and I'm going to say all are in, all are welcome. I'm going to establish justice in the earth by taking away the us and them mindset and saying no more us's and them's. Everybody's in. Us is them, them is us. I'm breaking down the dividing wall of hostility. A bruised reed I will not break, a dimly burning wick I'll not extinguish. That's justice, God says. But we think justice is retributive. We think justice is somebody's got to pay for these crimes. But God's sense of justice is completely different from ours. God's sense of justice is coming to the aid of those who are oppressed and hurting and dying. This same passage is quoted, I believe it's in the book of Matthew. And it's quoted saying that this was fulfilled, that Jesus began to fulfill this bringing forth justice in the earth by healing a crowd of people. He heals a bunch of people, and it says, this is written to fulfill what Isaiah said. He'll bring forth justice. It didn't look like he'll bring forth justice because somebody's got to pay for the crimes of Adam. Someone's got to pay for the original sin that God left unpunished. Somebody's got to do it. He's going to punish it in Jesus, and then he's going to be satisfied. That's not the justice that the Bible talks about. The justice that the Bible talks about is Jesus is going to come, and he's going to come alongside of the weak and the hurting and the broken and lift them up and exalt them. But we've gotten this justice thing all wrong. We think it's about the shedding of blood. God says, no. It's never been about the shedding of blood. It's been about rescue, not retribution. Hebrews 10, 4 through 10, we opened with it. It is impossible for the blood of bulls and goats to take away sins. Therefore, when Christ came into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering you did not desire, but a body you prepared for me. So get this, whatever's going to happen with the body that God prepared for Jesus, it doesn't have anything to do with sacrifice and offering in our traditional understanding of sacrifice and offering. Because our traditional understanding of sacrifices and offering is something spills its blood so something else can go free, so the gods can be appeased. But Jesus prefaces his statement about God preparing a body for him by saying, sacrifice and offering you didn't desire. So the body you prepared for me doesn't have anything to do with bloody appeasement. But a body you prepared for me with burnt offerings and sin offerings you were not pleased. Then I said, here's why the body was prepared. Then I said, here I am, it's written about me in the scroll. I've come to do your will, my God. First he said, sacrifices and offerings, burnt offerings and sin offerings. You didn't desire, nor were you pleased with them, though they were offered in accordance with the law. God was not pleased with them, nor did he desire them. He sets aside the first to establish the second. When he says, here I am, I've come to do your will. He detaches God's will from the idea of sacrifice. When he says, you don't desire sacrifices, you prepared a body for me, and I've come to do your will, he detaches the will of God from the offering of sacrifices. And he says, this is not the will of God, nor has it ever been. What I'm going to accomplish in my body is the will of God. And what does he accomplish in his body? Verse 10, by that will, the will that Jesus detached from the idea of sacrifices, by that will we have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. All. You see, here's what it's all about. Jesus comes and he takes upon himself the noun of sin, not just the verb of sin, but the structure of sin that we internalized over the years, which 1 John 3:8 calls the work of the devil. For this reason was the Son of God manifested, to destroy the devil's work. What was the devil's work? You go on to read, he's been sinning from the beginning. Sin is the devil's work. That's why in John chapter 8, we're told that the Pharisees wanted to carry out their father's desire. That's why they're called a brood of vipers, because they bore the image of the Edenic serpent. They did what he did. That's why they're called the offspring of vipers, because of the way that they lived. They were accusatory. They murdered. Okay? That was why he called them the sons of the devil, because they were sons of the accuser and they acted like him. It wasn't because they were born with some fallen nature in them that God had to judge. That's nonsense. That's mythology. It's because they acted in that sense. They acted as the accuser. They bore that image, they bore that likeness, because, and it says, you wanted to carry out your father's desire. Sin is the work of the devil. We internalized it over the years. And when Jesus comes, he takes our iniquities and our sins upon himself, and then in his death, he destroys that which was destroying us. We talk about sin and we see it as only being an action that God's mad about. You did wrong and God's mad that you did wrong. Sin's more than an action that God is mad about. Sin is a structure that we internalized over the years that was destroying us from the inside out. It was an alien ailment. It was a sickness. We've got to stop looking at sin in the context of human justice and law courts. We've got to take it out of the arena of the courtroom because that messes everything up. Then everything's just stainless steel and cold and stony and there's no life in it. But sin is not just about broken commandments that God needs to punish someone for breaking. Sin is an ailment that afflicted us and that brought death. It was a Trojan horse that entered our lives, and death entered through sin, the Bible says. And so we began to decay. We began to face corruption. Even though we were made in the image of God, because sin entered and brought death, we began to corrupt and decay. And so the image of God in man began to be subject to corruption and decay. And in Genesis 9:6, when they come out of the ark, God says to Noah, don't murder people. Why? Because I made them in my likeness. The reason God hates death so much is because it destroys and corrupts his image in man. And so death enters through sin. So God has to do away with sin so that he can do away with death so that he can rescue his image in man. We've got to stop looking at sin in the light of justice in a human sense, and we've got to start looking at it as justice in God's understanding of justice, because God's understanding of justice is rescue. It's coming to the aid of the oppressed and lifting them up out of darkness, lifting them up out of the pit, and that's precisely what justice is manifested through the cross, not sacrificial bloody justice where there has to be a victim who has to pay for some wrong that was done. The cross, Jesus detaches the work that he does in his body from the idea of animal sacrifices. He says, I've come to do your will. And it is detached from the idea of burnt offerings and sacrifices. And what is your will? To do away with sin in the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. Because through his death, he so allowed himself to be entangled with our issues that when he died, they died with him. He so allowed himself to be entangled with who we were in our lostness and in our blindness that when he died, who we were died with him. And it was rescue, not wrath. It was an act of heroism, not an act of twisted, deified Roman justice. It was God rescuing us. But we've taken it out of the arena of rescue, and we put it into a courtroom, and we wonder why nobody stands in awe of our gospel anymore. Because in our gospel, God is both the hero and the villain. He's the one we're saved. He's the one who's trying to do us harm, but he's also the one who saves us from himself. If he were a human being, we'd throw him in an institution if he was that off. I hate you, but I love you. I'm going to kill you, but I'm going to save you from myself. What in the world? And how do you ever feel safe with a God like that who can't make up his mind about whether he loves you or whether he hates you? Augustine said, he both loves us and hates us. How could you ever comfortably live with a God who is that bipolar? You never know. When he puts out his arms, if he's going to embrace you or if he's going to strangle you. Come on. And the picture I kind of painted this morning, but the picture most of, you know, that we hear about the cross is that daddy comes stumbling up the stairs after having had one too many bottles of wrath to drink, and he's mad as H-E double hockey sticks at Adam and his sin and his fallen race, and he comes stumbling up the stairs, and he needs a scapegoat. He needs somebody to let out his anger on, and he sees his youngest son across the hall, and he comes at him with everything he has, and he is going to beat the snot out of him. But at the very last minute, his older brother jumps in front of him and takes the beating of his daddy, and older brother's laying there, a bloody mess on the floor. And then father looks up at Junior from across the hall, and he says, hey, look, I'm feeling a whole lot better now. You want to go get some pizza and go bowling or something? That's the God we present the world with. Look, God was so mad at you, he wanted to kill you. And Good Friday services, you know, you always get the little invitations in the mail, and there's Jesus bloody and beaten on the cross with a little cute phrase like, it should have been me. Like, yeah, that's what God wanted to do to you. He was so mad at you. Why? Because you were born. You had the misfortune of being born with a fallen nature, and he just hated who you were. So that was supposed to be you. That's what he wanted to do to you. But thank God he did it to himself so he can let you off the hook. What a crazy God. And I'm supposed to look up at him like Junior, who just watched his brother get the snot beat out of him and said, sure, Dad, let's go bowling. I don't want anything to do with that God. I'm sorry. That God is a pagan God who deserves to die along with Zeus and all of the other pagan gods of antiquity. He doesn't look like Mount Zion. He looks like Mount Olympus, and I want nothing to do with him. Come on, you guys. Are you here tonight?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Jesus says, I've come to do your will, and it looks nothing like sacrifice. It looks nothing like bloody appeasement. It looks like rescue. It looks like saving you from sin, not taking a punishment you had coming because God was mad at some original sin some guy committed in a garden because a talking snake told him to. Oh, man. Some people will say, well, wait a minute. Doesn't the Bible say that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness? That unless blood is shed, God can't forgive. It does say that, but we often don't read the surrounding text. Hebrews 9, 22 through 23 says, in fact, the law requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. Well, there it is, proof text. God can't forgive without the shedding of blood. Well, listen to me. If God can't forgive without the shedding of blood, then God doesn't really forgive, because that's not forgiveness, that's justice in a human sense. That's not forgiveness. Forgiveness is not, if you called my wife a name, and I wanted to punch you in the face so bad. But instead, I walk up to some, I'm like, but you know what? I don't want to hurt them. So I just walk up to some innocent guy on the street and punch him in the face. Because I had to get my wrath out. And then I walk up and say, hi, I forgive you. Did I really forgive him? No, someone still had to experience my wrath. I didn't really forgive him. Forgiveness would be like, it's okay. Nobody needs to pay for this. There doesn't need to be a scapegoat. There doesn't need to be somebody to blame. No one has to squirm or suffer. I forgive you. That's forgiveness. But if God has to kill somebody in order to forgive you, that's not forgiveness. But the Bible says here, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. So how do you get around that? Verse 23. Well, you know what? Let's go back to verse 22, actually. The law requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. Who says without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness? The law says without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. Verse 23, it was necessary then for the copies of the heavenly things to be purified with these sacrifices. In other words, yes, so the temple was cleansed with physical blood, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. In other words, cleansing things with animal blood was just a shadow of what Jesus was going to accomplish. That doesn't mean that God can't forgive without there being bloodshed. It just simply was a shadow of something that Jesus accomplishes in eternity when he destroys the power of sin, and his blood is the evidence that there's been a death. That's all it was. But God doesn't say, I can't forgive or let you off the hook without the shedding of blood. The law said that. And it was just a shadow of the greater thing that Christ accomplished in eternity. Same chapter, verse 14, here's what we read about the blood. If the blood is really all for God, and God is just dissatisfied with the human race until that perfect sacrificial blood is given to him, and then he's like, ah, finally, you're all forgiven now. Then what do we do with verse 14? Because verse 14 says, how much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, offered himself as a sacrifice in the sense of laying down his life for another, not in the sense of take me, God, take my blood and spill my blood like some pagan god and drink it like a juice box. That's not how he offered himself to God. He offered himself to accomplish God's will, not as a bloody sacrificial victim. How much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death so we may serve the living God? Who did the blood affect, God? Was the blood for God? No. Were the animal skins in Eden for God? No, they were for us. Is the blood for God? No, the blood's for us. Because the blood of Jesus cleanses our consciences. Why? Because the blood of Jesus represents the fact that our sins have been taken away and destroyed. And when we know it, when we know the truth, we no longer feel guilty because we know sin has been destroyed in the body of Jesus Christ. The blood of Jesus did not change God's mind about us. The blood of Jesus changes our mind about God. Because we see a God who's willing to lay down himself and sacrifice himself to save us. Oh, yeah. Furthermore, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Hebrews 9:26 says this about what that shedding of blood looks like, if you even want to call it that and put it in that context. He has appeared once for all at the culmination of the ages to do away with sin by the sacrifice of himself. Listen to the heroism in those words. He has appeared once for all at the end of the ages to do away with sin by the sacrifice of himself. The sacrifice of himself, again, in a biblical way, meaning that he lays himself down for us. He becomes the hero that rescues us from the alien ailment that was bringing death and corruption to our lives. He rescues us in a heroic sense, not that he has to bow down before God and let God do his worst to him before he can forgive us. He sacrifices himself in the heroic sense of the word. He brings forth justice by doing right, by bringing justice into the earth, because it was unjust that God's creation was decaying and coming to naught. It was unjust that God's creation, that those who bore his image were struggling under the power of death. It was unjust. And so Jesus lays himself down as a heroic sacrifice to do away with the power of sin. Not because God was mad and needed a whipping boy or a punching bag. Thank you, Lord. Okay. I'm going to go through these next few scriptures very fast, but I hope you guys all still with me tonight. Is this making sense? Are you getting this? Okay, let's talk just for a minute about who actually killed Jesus, because still we got to answer that, because it's popularly taught that the Father killed Jesus, that the Father crushed him, that the Father is to blame. And if they really want to lay the guilt trip on you, they'll say you did it. Yeah. You crucified him. Let's look at who the Bible says crucified Jesus. Let's look at what the Bible teaches about this. Because you know, it's an important thing to do when we're talking about biblical doctrine. It's important to find out what the Bible actually teaches about this stuff. Instead of just pulling stuff out of our armpits and saying, this is what it says. And you just made that up in the car on the way to church. It's important that we actually understand what the Bible teaches about these things. Okay? Listen, Acts chapter 2, verse 36. Peter's preaching on the day of Pentecost, and he says, therefore, let all Israel, does that include you? No. Therefore, let all Israel, Israel when? 2,000 years ago, Israel. Does that include God? No. That includes a single nation, a fraction of whom missed their Messiah and handed him over to death. Peter says, therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Christ. Who crucified him? Who is responsible for his death? The Father? No. That faction of Israel who handed him over to death. God, on the other hand, is credited with raising him to life and making him king and Lord over all. You see, it doesn't say, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made Jesus, whom he both crushed beneath his wrath, Lord and Messiah. No, it says, you crucified him. That was your work. That was your handiwork. But God's work was raising him from the dead and making him Lord in Christ. See how God differentiates between Israel's work and his work. God was not the one who crushed him. God was not the one who killed him. Israel was. God's the one who raised him up, gave him life, and exalted him. Acts chapter 3, verses 14 through 16. Again, speaking to Israel. You disowned the holy and righteous one and asked that a murderer be released to you. You killed the author of life. Is that God they're talking about? And is that us 2,000 years later that he's talking about? No, that is that faction of Israel in collusion with Rome who handed Jesus over to be crucified. You killed the author of life, but God raised him from the dead. What did God do? God raised him from the dead. What did human beings do? Killed the author of life. Who's to blame for his death? Not God, Israel. Who's to blame for his resurrection? God. Again, God differentiates between his work and the work of sinful men. Acts 4, 10 through 11. Then know this, you and all the people of Israel. Again, are we talking about God? Are we talking about us? No. Then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which God has made the chief cornerstone. Again, notice God differentiates. You crucified him, you rejected him. God raised him from the dead and made him the chief cornerstone. God's work was not the death and murder of Christ, that was man's work. God's work was the exaltation and resurrection of Christ. Woo! Acts 5, 30 through 31. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead, whom you killed by hanging him on a cross. God exalted him to his own right hand as Prince and Savior, that he might bring Israel to repentance and forgive their sins. There's a whole message there that I won't go into, but look again. God raised Jesus from the dead, but Israel put him to death. Again, who's to blame for his death? not God. Who's to blame for his life? God. Now, what about Isaiah 53? Because a lot of people, even maybe some of you in this room, are thinking, but wait a minute, it says in Isaiah 53 that it pleased the Father to crush him, that it pleased the Lord to bruise him, that God was the one who bruised him and crushed him. Well, let's start in Isaiah 53, verse 4, and let's work our way towards verse 10, wherein we have those words, okay? So in verse 4, it says, surely he, Jesus, took up our pain and he bore our suffering, yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. Who are the ones who considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted? We did. We came up with that. We're the ones who looked at him when he was suffering and said, he's under the wrath and judgment of God. He's experienced the brunt of God's wrath right now. We knew it. He's a false Messiah. He's a false Christ. He heals by the power of the devil. That's what the Jews were saying as they're around the cross. He's under the wrath of God. We considered him stricken by God, smitten by him, and afflicted. But the truth is, he was carrying our sorrows. He was carrying our pain. It wasn't God's wrath he was suffering beneath the weight of. It was our suffering and our pain that he took upon himself, not the wrath of God. We came up with that. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Here's another zinger. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. And so we go to that and we're like, well, look, the punishment that brought us peace, the peace obviously being between us and God, because there's nothing else that could possibly mean, right? When we come at it with this presupposition that the cross is about God removing wrath through Jesus, we immediately read it into that. But if you don't come at it with that presupposition, you don't see that there. The punishment that brought us peace was on him. Yes, the death of Jesus Christ brings peace to our hearts and it brings peace to our lives. But when it says the punishment that brought us peace was upon him, that doesn't mean the punishment that God inflicted upon him. It just means the punishment that he endured when he was treated like a criminal by Israel. He was punished for a crime he didn't commit. It doesn't say that this punishment came from God. We're told just a few verses earlier that we're the ones who said he was being punished by God. So we can't read this verse as meaning that God was the one doing the punishing. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. Notice God didn't go astray. God didn't turn away because of sin, only return once sin was dealt with. We were the ones who went astray. We were the ones who went our own way. Why? Because sin caused us to do this. Sin caused us to wander because we didn't believe God was on our side anymore. We wandered away. But Peter, in his commentary on this same passage of Scripture, tells us that when Christ takes our sins upon himself and puts them to death, that we are empowered to return to the shepherd and overseer of our souls because sin made us wander. Didn't make God wander, didn't make him go astray. It made us wander, it made us go astray. And by his wounds, by him taking our sins into his flesh and drowning them beneath the waters of his love, by his wounds, we're healed. What are we healed from? We're healed from what sin brought into our lives where it made us wander. Now we're able to return. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Now we jump down to verse 10. Now remember, we've already seen in Isaiah's own words that we're the ones who called him punished by God, not God. Then when you get to verse 10, it says, yet it was the Lord's will to crush him. And if you stop there, you're like, it was the Lord's will to crush him. God was the one who crushed him. God was the active ingredient in Christ's suffering. It was God who was causing him to suffer. God was the one crushing him. But in Hebrew writing, there's something called the parallelism, not only in Hebrew writing, but in Hebrew writing especially, something is called the parallelism. You'll see it a lot in the Psalms and in the prophets' writing. You say one thing, and then you say another thing that means the exact same thing that gives definition to the thing you said before. Does that make any sense? And what we have here is a parallelism. It says, it was the Lord's will to crush him. Here's the parallel verse. Here's the parallel words. He has put him to grief. See, the first time around, it sounds like God is the one who's crushing him. Second time around, it gives it a little bit more definition that says he has put him to grief, or he is the one who caused him to suffer. But God, in that sense, is not the active ingredient in Christ's sufferings. He's simply the one who allowed it to take place. He was the one who handed him over to suffer, but he was not the author of his suffering. Because we already know from Isaiah's words, we were the ones who came up with the idea that he was punished by God, not God. God's not his active crusher. He was the one who handed him over. This is revealed in Acts 2, 22 through 24. Check this out. Fellow Israelites, Peter says, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. You see, it was still evil men man. It was still Israel in collusion with Rome who put him to death, but God handed him over in order to fulfill his purpose of doing away with sin in the body of his son. God, it was his will to crush him. He put him to grief. That doesn't mean he was the active crusher or the active ingredient in his suffering or that Christ suffered beneath the wrath of God. It means he handed him over, and then Israel crushed him, and they did what they wanted to do to him. He was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But once more, God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death because it was impossible for death to keep its hold at him. Again, once more, God hands him over because he's got a plan, he's got a purpose to fulfill. Israel does it, and they don't even know they're doing it. But they're still the ones who cause him to suffer. But what they don't realize is that in causing him to suffer, they're actually the ones who are taking part in putting death and sin to death in the body of Jesus. They don't know they're doing what they don't know what they're doing. They don't know they're part of some grand plan. But God hands him over, and they cause him to suffer and put him to death. And then once more, God's credited with giving him life, but not with crushing him or killing him. Once more, this is seen, Acts 13, 27 through 30. And I know this is a little heady and a little teachy tonight, but I hope you're getting something out of this. I'm sure having fun. In Acts 13, 27 through 30, the people of Jerusalem and their rulers did not recognize Jesus, yet in condemning him, they fulfilled the words of the prophets that are read every Sabbath. Once more, God handed Jesus over, and they fulfilled the words of the prophets that said he would save us from sin. God was not the one who crushed him beneath his wrath. He simply handed him over. And they all of a sudden found themselves as part of a plan they didn't even know they were part of. But God's not the one who caused him to suffer. They were. Though they found no proper ground for a death sentence, they asked Pilate to have him executed. And when they had carried out all that was written about him, did you hear that? When they had carried out all that was written about him, they took him down from the cross and laid him in a tomb. But God raised him from the dead. Once more, God's credited with handing him over so that the prophecies could be fulfilled, so his eternal plan could be fulfilled and we could be saved from sin, but he's not the one who poured out wrath on him. We poured out our wrath upon him. And then God raised him from the dead after he had experienced the full brunt of our wrath. I mean, can it be any more clear? The witness of the apostles over and over and again is that God is not the author of Jesus' death. It is not the wrath of God that killed Jesus. It was the wrath of man that killed Jesus. God's the one who gave him life. But man didn't realize that in putting him to death, they were putting sin to death. They didn't know that they were part of God's eternal plan. Haman didn't know when he built gallows for Mordecai and his family that he and his family would be impaled on them. He just didn't know it. You know what I'm saying? And the devil, whatever you want to say about it, the Pharisees, they didn't know that in putting Jesus to death, they were putting sin and death to death. They didn't understand that they were complicit in the plan of God. They had no idea what they were fulfilling. But it wasn't the wrath of God that killed Jesus. It was the wrath of man that killed Jesus. But the wrath of man even served to accomplish God's eternal purposes. God is the one who raised him to life, not the one who crushed him and killed him. I hope you're getting something out of this. Think about this then. Jesus did not die beneath the wrath of God. Because the wrath of God is not a quantifiable substance that had been building up since Eden that he was obligated to pour out on us. Unless, of course, one stepped forward and volunteered to take it all. That was not what the wrath of God was. That's not the way it worked. That is complete and utter mythology. That is not the narrative in which the apostles located themselves. That would have been a completely foreign concept to the Jews. They would have been like, what are you talking about? That is such a pagan idea. You don't find it in the writings of the Old Testament. You don't find it in the writings of the New Testament. You find it in the writings of Augustine. You find it in the writings of Anselm. And then you find the reformers really getting all hopped up on it in the 1500s. But you certainly don't find it in the Bible. Because God is not a sacrifice-demanding deity who needs blood to satisfy his justice. Justice is God rescuing you from death and from sin. It's heroism. It's rescue, not retribution. Jesus divorces the will of God from the concept of sacrifice and says God's will is not bloody appeasement. God's will is saving you from your sins. But here's how we're going to accomplish this. I'm going to take that sin on myself, and then I'm going to thrust myself into the hands of sinners. I'm going to allow them to do their worst to me. But what they don't realize is they're going to be complicit in the plan of God to do away with sin through my crucifixion. And then my Father is going to raise me to life. See, Jesus is not on the cross alone saving you from God. The Bible says that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not counting man's sins against them. 2 Corinthians 5. God was not removed from Jesus. Jesus is all alone saving you from God. I think it's in Zechariah 12:10. It says, Yahweh says, Yahweh, the Old Testament designation for Father God, Yahweh says they will look upon me, Yahweh, the Father. They will look upon me, the one that they've pierced, and they will mourn for him as for an only son. Did you hear that? Yahweh, the Father, says they'll look on me, the one they pierced. I didn't see anybody piercing the Father. And then they'll mourn for him as one mourns for an only son. Who's the him? The him is Jesus. Who's the me? Yahweh, the Father. In other words, the Father suffered with Christ. He wasn't separated from the cross. He was with Christ, suffering with him. It's rescue. See, the cross is meant to inflame our hearts with love for our Savior. It's meant to, we look on it and we see the fact that God sacrifices himself heroically to save us from sin and death. And our hearts catch fire with love for him. But instead, we've looked at the cross and we've heard a father abusing his son, when really it's just a father saving his son from killer bees. But we've stood outside in our immaturity thinking that the Father is abusing the Son on the cross. And that's what the Father wanted to do to me. And the only reason he doesn't do it to me is because he did it to Jesus. That doesn't inflame my heart with love. That makes me feel attached to Jesus but repulsed by the Father. In fact, when I was over my head in this type of theology, and I used to be over my head in this type of theology, and I used to preach it and I used to teach it often. In fact, it was one of the hallmark messages that I preached and taught. I would be praying, and I would find myself so attached to Jesus, but repulsed by the Father, and I had no idea why. Yeah. I had no idea why I felt this way towards the Father. I couldn't connect with him. I couldn't really feel this union with the Father, but I felt loved by Jesus. I felt adored and saved by Jesus. When it came to the Father, though, I just was... And I remember even thinking to myself one time, he has got to feel a little bit bitter towards me for having to treat his son the way he treated him when I'm the one who did all the junk. You've got to feel a little bit bitter towards me. I remember having thoughts like that about the Father. That's what that type of theology bred in me. That's not the work of the Spirit. The work of the Spirit is to teach you to cry, Abba, Father. That was teaching me to say something else to God than Abba, Father. That was teaching me to say abuser instead of Abba. Oh, my God. Aren't you thankful that that's not who our God is? Aren't you thankful that the God revealed in Jesus is not some sacrifice-demanding, blood-drinking Moloch? Check this out. Hebrews 12, verse 3. And this, to me, is the most moving aspect of the work of Christ. Even more than being saved from sin and death. And that's pretty darn moving. But this moves me more than anything else. Hebrews 12, 3 says, consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself. From whom did Christ experience hostility? From the Father or from sinners? From sinners. Consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself. Just press pause for a moment and think about that. The God who made man's mouth endured insults from those same mouths. He allowed those same mouths to spit at him and hurl insults at him. He allowed the hands that he formed to rip the beard from his face and drive nails through his hands and feet. He endured hostility from sinners. Consider the fact that the one who gave them breath had his breath taken away by them. Consider that. That the God who breathed them into existence asphyxiated while under their watch. Think about that. Consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself. Consider, not sinners in the hands of an angry God, but God in the hands of angry sinners. Think about that. Think about God suffering at our hands. Think about God thrusting himself into our hands and saying, do your worst to me. And every savage, brutal, primal desire that we had, that we had always dreamed about pouring out on this God whom we were enemies in our minds with. The Bible says the sinful mind is hostile to God. The Bible says we became enemies in our minds because of evil behavior. We were not on friendly terms with God up here. We hated him. And so when one claiming to be his son came among us, you better believe we were going to do all we desired to him. And Israel pours out all of their wrath and all of their fury on Jesus. You know the word excruciating? Ever see the word that's sandwiched in between X and ing? excruciate. Where does that come from? From crucifixion. The word excruciating was created to describe the pain of crucifixion. Because it was such a painful death, no word could describe it. So a word is created, excruciating. And it describes the pain of crucifixion. Consider God, who is eternal love, who thrust himself into our hands and let us do our worst to him. We ripped him to ribbons. We beat him beyond human recognition. And all he ever did was love us. And all he was doing in the midst of it was saving us. But the human race treated him like garbage. Consider him who endured such hostility against himself. And then Luke 23, 33 through 34 says, when they came to the place called the skull, they crucified him there along with the criminals on his right and the other on his left. And Jesus said, Father, forgive them because they don't know what they're doing. Come on! The nature of God is revealed right there. Look no further. Don't go flipping back to Job. Don't go peering through Jeremiah. Look right there, and you have the nature of God revealed. He thrusts himself into our hands, says, do your worst to me. All of your abuse, all of your hostility, all of your anger, pour it out on me. I can take it. And we do it, and we treat him like an animal. We treat him like a criminal. We treat him like garbage. And then he looks back, and he says, Father, forgive them. They have no idea what they're doing. If they did, they wouldn't be doing it. But they don't know, so forgive them. They didn't repent. They didn't pray a sinner's prayer. They didn't ask for forgiveness, and they most certainly weren't sorrowful. They were enjoying every minute of it. And in the midst of it, he looks up and he says, Father, forgive them. You're doing your worst to me. I've thrust myself into your hands, and I've let you do whatever you want to do to me. And I've done this for one reason, because I'm here to change your mind about who my daddy is, because you think my daddy's just like you. You think that, come on, you think God is just like you, and if you were in my place, you'd be spitting back right now. You would use your last breath to hurl the most vile insult you could in my direction if you were in my place. But now, God the Son, here I am suffering beneath your wrath, but instead of returning evil for evil, all I've got for you is this: I forgive you. I love you. You're precious to me. You have not changed my mind about you. You don't know what you're doing. And I don't hold you accountable for this because you don't understand. I forgive you. I let you off the hook. And in that one single act, God makes all the crooked things we've believed about him straight. In one move, he untwists all of our twisted notions about him. All of the mythology of the fall is undone here. When we are at our worst, crucifying and murdering God. Such a thing was never possible. He made it possible so we could commit the worst crime imaginable, so he could look back at us and forgive us and say, I'm not like you. I'm not retributive. I'm not about wrath. I don't need someone's blood for your blood. I forgive you. You're off the hook. 1 John 3:16 says, this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. It doesn't say this is how we know what love is. God demanded payment for sin, and so he took Jesus' life from him. It says, this is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ, very God of very God, lays his life down willingly. It wasn't demanded of him. He lays it down to show us what love really is, because we did not know. Our understanding of God had become warped and skewed. We lost it. We did not know who he was. And Jesus thrusts himself into our hands, lets us do our worst so he can turn to us and forgive us and totally change our minds about who the Father is. And somehow, this most beautiful thing called the cross has gotten warped and twisted to where we hear a father beating his son instead of a father saving the human race and showing us mercy and compassion. We've stood outside the house, and because we don't know the nature of the Father, We hear the smacks and we hear the son screaming. And we don't realize he's being saved from bees. We think he's being abused because we don't know who God is. But man, when we get it right, when we get it straight, when we see the truth. See, I can't help but not love the God who creates me broken, demands me to get fixed, and when I can't, demands my life. And when he decides he doesn't want my life, he takes his own son's life instead and just presents himself as being some kind of absolute crazed buffoon. I can't help but not love that God. I can't help but be repulsed by him, actually. I've renounced him 1,000 times because he's not real. He is satanic. But I can't help but love the God who let us do our worst to him and says, I forgive you. I'm only here doing this because I love you in the first place. But in the midst of saving you from sin, I'm also going to give you a little lesson on my nature. Do your worst and I'll forgive you. No sacrifice required. No, I'm sorry, no apology note. Just do your worst and I'll forgive you. When we start seeing and preaching the cross like that, let me tell you something. Our message will become irresistible. But until then, it's very resistible. In fact, it's repulsive. But when we get this right, everything else makes sense. And the Father becomes someone beautiful to us, not someone repulsive. And the Son's not the scapegoat. It's beautiful. And God was never against me. He was always for me because Jesus wasn't saving me from God. He was saving me with God. He's only ever been on my side. Never changed his mind about me. I changed my mind about him. And the cross doesn't change God's mind back about me. It changes my mind about God. And that is the most beautiful message that any ears could ever take in. Because it's an eternal truth about God that's been lost beneath the dust of the fall. But the winds of Reformation are blowing the dust away. And we're starting to see the truth again. The eternal truth revealed in Jesus. God is love, and he's only ever been on your side. He's not into bloody appeasement or sacrifice. He's into real justice. And real justice looks like saving the weak who can't save themselves. And that's what he accomplished. And that is the gospel. Listen to this. In every other religion, the gods are on the sides of the power brokers. In every other world religion, the gods are on the sides of the higher-ups. They're on the side of the upper-crusty priest class and on the side of the monarchs. And they can use the names and natures of the gods in order to get rid of those they don't like, in order to commit genocide and do whatever they want. They can use the names of their gods to victimize the masses because the gods are on the sides of the power brokers. But in Jesus, there's a grand reversal. Because now we see a God who's not on the side of the victimizers. He's on the side of the victims. He's joined himself with the victim. And he shows his solidarity with the victim. And God shows his solidarity with the victim by raising his son up from victimization so as to say, I won't tolerate this anymore. This is over. I'm with the victim. I'm with the weak. I'm with the poor. And I won't let them lay in the dust of death anymore. I'm raising them up. Guys, the cross is a beautiful thing. Don't be deceived. Don't be misled. It's not about a child abusing God. It's about a God who loves you so much that there's no depth he wouldn't swim to save you. That's the cross. That's the gospel. And it's beautiful. Take it in. Drink it in. Let it change and revolutionize your life. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank you tonight for Jesus. Father, we thank you for the work of your Son that was not performed to get you back to your factory settings where you liked us again. The work of your Son was to reveal to us that we've only ever been loved and that we were worth saving and that we were worth redeeming. Ah, that's what the work of your Son shows us. Father, by the Spirit, let it become real to us. Let the Spirit within us teach us to cry, Abba, Father, to get rid of the abusive Father and teach us to say, Abba, Father. We want to see you as you are. God, the filth of this old penal substitution model, God, wipe it off of our lenses by the Spirit. And let us see truth. God, I pray there be a company in this region that would rise up with the real message of the cross burning in them. And that they would get passionate about the gospel because they see what it says about them and what it says about the human race. You'd raise up a company whose hearts are on fire with this message. And you would turn this region upside down through them. God, do it. Let somebody's heart catch fire tonight with this reality. Let somebody's heart catch fire with this reality tonight. Let somebody listening to this CD months later catch fire with this reality. God, let it be. Let it